Wonderful. Thank you so much, Dr. Vilar-Sanchez. And we certainly have a lot of questions that, coming in through through the Q&A here. I know this has been a hot topic for some time, and the more we hear about these vaccines, the more excited we are to see where the science leads us. You know, I think a number of the questions kind of boil down to the idea of how can people participate, or how can people stay abreast of what's going on. What would your recommendations be for some of our audience members who may be interested in exploring whether or not they would be eligible, wanting to participate, recognizing that, you know, people may be located all over the place here?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So there are several considerations when Lynch syndrome carriers are approaching us for participation in a clinical trial. The audience should know that these two trials are relatively different. Trial with the NuScom vaccine is a phase one. It means it's a vaccine that is in earlier stages of development. To be able to participate in that clinical trial, potential participants will need to be seen in one of the participating sites. So obviously there is consideration of where participants are located and whether or not they are available or have the means to travel back and forth. These clinical trials, particularly those that are in earlier stages, such as the NuScom clinical trial, is not only coming and receive the vaccine and the boost. There are other things that need to be done inside of the clinical trial, such as blood collection to assess immunogenicity over time and getting the scopes done in the participating sites. But nonetheless, if a patient is willing and has the means to articulate all of this, they are welcome to approach any of the investigators of the four sites, which are MD Anderson in Houston, Fox Chase Cancer Center in Philadelphia, University of Puerto Rico in San Juan, and City of Hope in Los Angeles. Welcome as well to send me an email and I can facilitate interactions. Although in the clinicaltrials.gov website for this particular trial, there is the name of the, and I believe that even the email address of the site PIs. For the second clinical trial, the trivalent vaccine trial, it's a vaccine that has been around a little bit longer. It's also a very different mechanism of action, as I have explained in the talk. It's going to be a larger trial with more sites. For those of you attending that are in the Boston area or New England area, Dana-Farber Cancer Institute is going to be one of the sites of that clinical trial. So that it might be easier for potential patients to come to you guys and get there and enroll. Again, different structure and more injections because the vaccine is different, but it's also a very interesting mechanism of action. I think there were questions about what happens if the patient is in Canada. We have had patients approaching to us from Canada, Australia. Everything boils down as whether or not their insurance will allow to receive care in the United States and in one of the sites that are participating in the clinical trial. I will add as well that these are NCI-sponsored clinical trials, so these are not industry sponsored clinical trials. So the federal government budget for these studies has a little bit, the pockets are not so deep as in industry sponsored clinical trials. So they certainly appreciate the involvement of the hereditary cancer syndrome community, the Lynch syndrome community, but they cannot reimburse for traveling expenses and things like that. I mean, there are some financial help, but is really, really restricted, and it comes down almost to something that is parking payments and things like that. So it's not it is not great what we can offer in terms of that.
Can you speak at all to the timelines here? Asking you to look into a crystal ball, if these vaccines are ultimately helpful, you know, what does it look like as far as these being available further and wider, for outside of clinical trials, and how long does it take to figure this out, especially if we're looking at populations of previvors?
Yeah. That's an excellent question. As you all may know, the process to implement and bring an intervention to the market or the general public, it's a lengthy project and it's a lengthy timeline. We have all seen, for example, that vaccines for COVID were implemented in an amazing timeline, but basically because the population that was eligible for this trial was by virtual human population in the world, right? So it's going to come down to how fast these trials are able to accrue, enroll, get completed, and then move up in the drug development ladder, right? For the NuScom vaccine, for example, we are at the beginning of the process. So I wanted to be optimistic. I know that there is a strong involvement from the Lynch syndrome community, but it's going to take years to get to a phase 3 clinical trial and a potential subsequent approval. For the trivalent vaccine, there is more work that has been already done. And so we are closer, we are in phase 2B. But we have to show that there is obviously clinical benefit, right? On all of this, that we are actually effectively preventing cancer with these vaccines. So although with the trivalent vaccine, we might be closer, but also understanding that it will be as well several years to get to the general population, but it's going to take some time.
And with what you were telling us about just kind of the biology underlying some of these vaccine studies, wondering if you can speak at all to, you know, just things that that our Lynch syndrome patients can be doing on their own, you know, to either boost their own immunity or, you know, in the name of cancer prevention. I know in the talk before this, or the talks before this, we heard from Dr. Dealey Conright about the benefits of exercise. Do we know, you know, other things that can play into immune activation or things along those lines?
Yeah, no, that's excellent. That's an excellent question. We have some sort of evidence that probably use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents could activate the immune system that is resident in the colon, in the large bowel. We have chemoprevention approaches that patients can take, such as aspirin, and probably aspirin or even naproxen could help to boost immunity there. I love when you're mentioning exercise, and we are working with Christina very closely. We have some preliminary data with a short study that we have performed here in MD Anderson with an exercise intervention, where we have also shown that it generates immune activation. So I think there are pharmacological intervention and non-pharmacological intervention that for sure can help patients to boost their immune system. Healthy lifestyles for sure is part of that. And hopefully we are working on getting our data published, but I think we are going to get close to have an exercise prescription at some point that patients can take and basically help to boost their immunity. And I think that is going to probably modify cancer risk. Now, we're talking in general, talking about this in general, obviously I cannot say if you exercise X number of times per week and you do this exactly, that's going to lead to a reduction in this percentage. But I think these are easy enough interventions that in general can impact health, not only cancer risk, but cardiovascular health. And that there are very cost efficient and for sure helpful for the Lynch syndrome population.
Wonderful, thank you. I see Dr. Singal on there. I don't know if you had one last question before we move on.
Sure. If you, I know we're running low on time, but Eduardo, I wonder if we to go back to the timeline issue. I think it's a great opportunity to talk about maybe the potential for patients to drive this in terms of advocacy, you know? And I don't know if you've been working with patient advocates. I think COVID was a great demonstration of that things can be done quickly. And obviously, as you said, part of that was that there was a huge population at risk. But I think that, you know, maybe you can speak to how the Lynch syndrome patient community and the advocacy could help drive some of the science forward to help you in your work.
Yeah. Absolutely. I think a strong involvement from our patient community is essential. And we can see it in many different ways, right? From the investigator standpoint, many times when we talk about patient advocacy, we are thinking on numbers. How can we bring patients to trials? But that's only one layer. Mm-hmm. That is also to breaking some of the myths that are in clinical research. For example, the other day was one of our coordinators was discussing with a potential enrollee about participating in these clinical trials, and one gets surprised on some of the statements that are there, like I don't want it to be a guinea pig or things like that. And I think working with our patients and families, we can probably communicate better how clinical research is done and is not exactly being a guinea pig, but participating basically in the process of developing all of this and being a strong partners, and also reassuring any potential candidates that participating in a clinical trial is probably the safest environment where you can take an intervention. And there is a lot of people taking care of you, a lot of people that are there for you, with you, supporting in all of the process. So it's not only engaging the patient advocates on getting patients aligned on this. This is obviously very, very important, and we definitely need the support from our patient community to get these trials done. And the faster that the process is, the better it's going to be for everybody, because we will be able to move up, hopefully, or even to rule out if some of these interventions are not really beneficial. I strongly believe that they will be, but obviously we have also to understand that trials are trials. We are trying to discover something that we don't know if it's still there, right?
Well, I think that's a wonderful segue into our next talk. But wanted to thank you again for your wonderful keynote speech and for all the exciting work that you're doing in the field here. So thank you again for spending your Saturday with us.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate the opportunity to talk to all of you. And these type of events are crucial in everything that we do, and so I really appreciate the opportunity to be with all of you here today.